This week on Maker Update, a pie clicker, a credit card-sized Cyberdeck, losing all your marbles, and a better tape measure. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update, the show where we find all the cool stuff that makers are making and share them with you so hopefully you can get inspired for your next project. I'm Tyler Weingartner and I hope you're all doing great. We've got a fun show for you, so let's check out the project of the week. It's been a few weeks since Pi Day, but that's no reason to skip out on this impressive Pi computer by the Science Elf. Once you start it, it will just merrily click and blink away as it churns out another digit of Pi, which it prints out on a length of thermal paper. Simple enough, right? It turns out that since the invention of digital computers, calculating the digits of Pi has been a fairly trivial task. So far, we've calculated Pi out to a trillion digits. That's a lot. So why build a machine to do it? The Science Elf is going in a bit more of a traditional direction and making the computation circuit of this project without the advantage of modern processing. In fact, he's not even using transistors. He's using relays. If you think about it, a relay is functionally identical to a transistor. Depending on the input signal, it will switch its output from one conductor to another. And if you chain enough of them together in a meaningful manner, you've got a basic computational cluster. And if you chain a whole lot of them together, you've got a computer. A computer that makes a beautiful symphony of clicky racket. It's not the most rudimentary computer I've seen recently, but it's awfully close. He also briefly explored the idea that he would also use the relays as memory, but quickly realized that almost all the relays would be devoted to this task. To make it more scalable, he's adding in a Raspberry Pi, but only to use it as volatile memory for the relay computations. He acknowledges that this earns the project a little bit of side-eye, but at least the name checks out, right? The Pi is also doing a little bit of extra lifting. Because relays occasionally fail due to heat buildup, the Pi is also running a similar calculation to verify the results from each bank of relays. And if the result is off, it sends a signal to reset and recalculate that digit. It also displays output to a monitor to debug visually, and it's also running the thermal printer. This is a fun and gloriously nerdy project, and I love it. More projects. JBV Creative wants to show you the most satisfying thing you'll see today. And his hypothesis is that since seeing one marble swirl around a gravity well is pretty satisfying, a whole lot of marbles going down a gravity well should be super satisfying. More is more, right? Like with just about all of his projects, he shares all of his engineering steps, especially his inspirations. This marble hopper is more or less based on a gumball machine, and you get to see his various iterations until he gets to the right marble flow. The marble lifter is based on an agricultural grain elevator. I haven't even seen all the marbles yet, and this is already a really satisfying video. Check it out. A few weeks ago, we talked about this super tiny Cyberdeck by Michael Clements. But from Jared Carillo, we have one that's even smaller. This is actually the second version of his Cyberdeck. And it's a pocket-sized touchscreen computer based around the Raspberry Pi Zero that works like a mini hacking tool, similar to the Flipper. It uses the Pi Moroni Hyperpixel touchscreen, and it has this gorgeous machined aluminum housing, plus this clever DIY battery cartridge that slots into the bottom. This one is still a work in progress, since it turns out the Pi Zero doesn't have enough grunt for what he wants. So check out his channel to catch the updates. Liz Clark has built a tiny CircuitPython controller for Elgato lights. These lights are Wi-Fi enabled, so you can control them using a web interface to adjust their brightness and color temperature. This device sends the same web commands, but in a tidy interface with an OLED screen, a rotary encoder, and a few buttons. There's a button to switch the light on and off, another to update the light with its new settings, and a third one to pull the settings from the light, which is useful when you're switching between the web interface and this controller. And I love the design of this little enclosure. Super compact and easy to assemble. Time for some tips and tools. Chris Borge has released a 3D printed design for a ball vise, which he believes is a tool that every creative person can find a use for. The body of the ball vise is all 3D printed, other than this rubber ring. He uses cement to weigh it down with some old rusty fasteners for additional weight and some filler to not waste cement. He also includes 3D printed files for a bunch of different work holding tools like vises, jaws, painting handles, and a few others. I've never been good at drawing, and I've always had kind of a hang up about that. As it turns out, Martina's partner Hansi from the Nerdforge channel can't draw either. And she's determined to see if she can help him learn to draw in just 100 hours. Part of this video is dedicated to the whole sweat equity of things. Some things you're just not going to be good at until you put in the work and stick it out, even when you have to struggle through being terrible at it. You get to see Hansi work through all the highs and the plateaus, but you also get to see the value of a good coach. When you're struggling to learn a new skill, every moment seems painful, and 100 hours seems like a marathon you'll never finish. But if you just commit to it, you can get there. Maybe I can too. And if you're interested in trying, check out the links in this video because there is a ton of great drawing learning resources here. Over on Instructables, I found this guide by Randomona to making vintage style gemstones out of hot glue. She starts by flattening out a wad of Play-Doh that will serve as the mold material. And then she looks through her assorted greeblies to find parts to press into the dough to make the shape. She gives a couple of different examples of various shapes for different gems. Fill it with hot glue, let it cool, and then paint. You will probably destroy the mold by removing the gem, but hey, at least that means they're all unique. And finally, Laura Kampf loves tape measures, but hates just one thing about them, the belt clip. For her, they just never sit right. Her shirt ends up covering it up, or the tape measure gets knocked loose by the armrest in her car. So she built this custom clip strap for her favorite tape measure. It's made of nylon webbing, and it has a sturdy clip on the end to clip it to your belt, or a pocket, or anywhere else that seems useful to you. There's a bonus magnet for holding on to driver bits, and I love this tip for making holes in the middle of the webbing using a soldering iron. I'm sure it smells terrible, but it makes a nice clean hole for screws or grommets, and it shouldn't fray either. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, we're checking in on the Tomorrow Lab crew, where they're building an AI vision pet food bowl using the Analog Devices Max 78000, a low-power microcontroller that can identify the pet it's supposed to be feeding, as well as the pet it isn't. When the correct pet wanders in front of the bowl, the servo will actuate, the doors will open, and the food will become available. Otherwise, the doors close, and better luck next time. Cool stuff. Check it out. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. Thank you so much for watching. And remember, you can find out more about every single one of these tips and projects by following the links down in the description. While you're there, leave us a comment, give us a thumbs up, and hit subscribe so you don't miss the next one. Remember, don't adopt any strange plants during the eclipse next week. Big thanks to DigiKey for making this whole show possible and to you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.